Hi, I'm Andrew Childress for Beebole, and in this video, I'm really excited to show you how to build a time tracking dashboard that you could use in Microsoft Excel. This dashboard is going to help you really dive deep into understanding what your team's working on right inside of Excel. And you can see here an example of what we're kind of working towards. You can see I can quickly and easily click around on different objects in these tools called slicers, and that helps me really drill down on exactly the data that's in my Beebole timesheet data. So let's go ahead and jump over to the Beebole dashboard. And you know, we already do have some great tools that help us explore our data. We've got charts and graphs and some ad hoc reports that can show us what our team's working on. But sometimes you just want to work in Excel. Maybe you want to marry it up to some finance data or some other data that's already inside of a workbook. So what we're going to do is download the data from Beebole and find a way to work with it in Excel so that it's easy to keep up to date and keep our dashboard in view. Now, the first thing that I want to do is go ahead and make sure I have a few settings dialed in, and these are the localization settings. So of course, nowadays everybody's working in different regions, we have a lot of remote teams, and I have a different way of working with the data than some others on my team. So in my case, what I always like to do is check the local settings and make sure I'm getting the data in a format that makes sense for me. I'll use the decimal format for numbers because I'm in the US and the thousand separator with a comma and make sure that my dates are set up in the US format. Now, these aren't a must, but they are nice to have if everyone's okay with you working with the data in this way, the way that you need to. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and jump back to our dashboard here, and we're going to be working in the report data section for this video. Remember, what we're trying to do here is get the data out of Beebole so that we can work with it in Excel. And what report data really does is you can kind of see like an ad hoc report here of what you're working on. And we could look at some of the fields we're interested in here, but what I really want to do instead is download all of the data from Beebole and make it available to use in Excel so that I always have what I need and can just slice and dice to find it easily. So the first thing I want to do is just adjust this report so that I have everything I need in Excel. Let's go ahead and click on Change This Report. So I've got these different fields here, right? And each of these help us see a different part of the data that we capture in Beebole. But there's one thing I want to go ahead and add to this, and that's actually the date. I want to get all the way down to the bottom level detail, and then I can just use it in Excel. If I want to do a summary, for example, I can just remove certain fields and look at it at a high level, but it's much better that we go ahead and grab everything. What we really want to do is get Excel with the date on each row so that each row is its own record. So I'm going to go ahead and move date to the left, and then I think I'm okay with all these other fields that I currently have in the report. Let's go ahead and give a name to this report, and I'll call it Output for Excel. Now I can go ahead and just click on Run the Report. And you can see all the data's here, just the way we need it. We've got each row representing a different date that we captured data for, and so this is great. This is pretty much exactly what we need. Let's go ahead now and click on this CSV button. And what that's going to do is actually download the data that we're going to use into Excel. Now what we want to do is move this data to a folder that Excel will keep its eye on. I'm going to go ahead and click on the arrow here and choose Show in Folder. So now what I'm going to do is switch over to my desktop here, and I'm going to put this data into a folder that Excel is going to monitor for me. Let's go ahead and create a new folder, and I'll call it Time Tracking Data. Now let's move that CSV file we downloaded to the Time Tracking Data folder. Okay, let's go ahead and start a new session of Excel. Now, all of these steps that I'm taking so far, they're really just one-time steps. There's something that you set up once, and then you can just refresh everything, and everything works nice and easy. So I'll choose a blank workbook here, and now I've got a new session of Excel I can work in. Okay, what I'm going to do is come up to the Data tab, and this is where we start setting up what I like to call the data pipeline. It's the series of steps that really monitors the data for us. We set a folder to watch and keep it rolled in and refreshed in Excel. Let's go ahead and click on Get Data, and I'm going to choose From File, From Folder, as you're seeing me do here. And now what we need to do is actually just go ahead and point it to that folder that we just set up. So I'm going to go ahead and use the time tracking data and then click on OK, and click OK again. Now, this new preview window shows you that it sees the data in the folder that we just set up. So all we really need to do at this point is go ahead and say Combine and Load To. And you can see another preview here that shows our data is looking great, ready to work with it, and I'll go ahead and click OK. And let's go ahead and click on Only Create Connection and add this data to the data model. And again, you don't have to understand all these steps that we're doing here in detail. Just know that basically what we're doing is we're making it available for Excel to work with. I'll go ahead and click on OK now. So now you can see this queries window over here actually shows the data that's behind the scenes that's ready for us to work with. Now's a great time to go ahead and save our dashboard as well. So I'm going to go ahead and just do that quickly on my side so that we make sure we have our file saved safely. All right, and now we're really ready to start working with the report. So let's go ahead and close this out so that we don't see it anymore to have a little more screen to work with. And let's click on Power Pivot now. Now, you might have worked with pivot tables in the past, and Power Pivot is really kind of the same thing. It's just magic at working with that behind the scenes data in the data model that we just set up. So in normal Excel, you know, we could actually see the data in the spreadsheet, but in our case, it's in the data model. So it's kind of magically hooked up behind the scenes. It's pointing to that data in the folder that we set up earlier. Let's go ahead and click on Manage here. And when this pops up, you can see that's where all of our data is. So it's looking to that CSV file that we downloaded to work with. Now I'll click on Pivot Table here and let's go ahead and choose Existing Worksheet and click OK. All right, we're good to go now. So if you've never used a pivot table before, this is really where the magic begins. Let's go ahead and make sure that we're clicked inside of the pivot table because we'll want to be able to see this pivot table field section. And if you can't see it, just double check on the Analyze menu here under Pivot Table Tools that Field List is showing. So let's go ahead and click on this drop down arrow so that we can see all of the fields that are available. And what you'll notice here is that each one of these fields is actually a column, a set of data from our original data that we downloaded from Beebole. And these four boxes here below are actually how we build out a report, because a pivot table is really just that reporting tool that hooks to data. So you'll notice the fields here are labeled filters, columns, rows, and values. And depending on where I put a field is how the pivot table behaves. So if I take person and move it to rows, you'll see each person on their own row. But if I put it in columns instead, then you can see that the columns represent each person in our data set. I'm going to go ahead and pull that field out for now. And let's start off by putting company in the rows list. Now, this doesn't really tell me anything about how we're working with our data or what projects are being worked on. So one of the most important things that we need to do is actually put the hours in the values field. So this values field is always reserved for numeric values. I'm going to go ahead and put hours down there, and you can see now that I actually have a representation of the hours that we spent on each project. Now, it's important to note that we can go down to two levels of data with a pivot table as well. If I put project below company, I could see how many hours are on each project for a company. Or if I move project to filters, now I can filter based on the types of projects I'm interested in. So if I click on long range planning, as you're seeing me do here, for example, and click OK, you can see that now my table only shows those hours associated with that. Let's go ahead now and actually turn this back to all. And now I want to show you one of the magic features about pivot tables that really helps you understand the data in one. Let's click on Insert Slicer. Now on the Insert Slicer menu, let's go ahead and check a couple of boxes like company, date, person, and project, and think of these as the controls over our pivot table. And what you'll see here is actually these four windows that pop up that represent each of the settings that we just chose. Now what these slicers really do and control is that they change the data that's being fed to the pivot table. So let's say that I was only interested in a series of dates, like what did we do in June, for example. When I click on one of the June dates, the pivot table automatically updates. It only shows the data that's part of the June data set. Now if I hold shift and click on another date in the list, what will actually happen is the pivot table will show that entire range of dates. So by now, I think it's probably pretty clear how powerful this can really be to drill down on what someone's working on. I could click on a name, for example, and see actually what that individual is working on. Or I could click on a series of people by holding control and clicking on them, and the pivot table automatically updates. So it's always going to show the way that I've selected fields on the slicers here on the right side. So the way that I like to think about these pivot tables is that they help me answer questions about my data. They help me answer questions like what did we do for Duke and do between a certain set of dates, for example. And that gives understanding in a sea of large data. That's really what it's all about, is using these controls and tools to really tease out the answers to questions. Now, as I mentioned earlier, don't miss out on the fact that you can always come back and keep changing this report on the Analyze Field List option. And also, don't forget that these reports are really flexible. You could just as easily copy it and make a separate pivot and have the person on each line instead. But it's really up to you to think about how you want to explore your data. What views do you really need to answer those questions that come up most often? You've got the tool, and now you just have to manipulate it to really understand what's going on in your team. Now, one last thing I do want to show you is that as you update the folder that holds your data, it's really easy to keep the pivot up to date. Let's say that I put a new file with old data in the time tracking data folder here, like for 2019 if I had it. All I have to do is go up to the data tab and click on refresh all, and it'll all automatically feed this pivot table with that up-to-date data. And that's really all there is to it. Download your data, hook it up to Excel, and then start answering those questions that have eluded your understanding thus far. Thanks so much for watching.